following interview was conducted with Professor Linnell Geddes for the Purdue University Oral History Program. It took place on Tuesday, March 6, 2007, at Stewart Center in the Dean's Administrative Offices. The interviewer is Catherine Marquis, the Oral History Librarian. Welcome. Tell us a little bit about where you were born and your family and siblings.
I was born in Houston, and my family was, the whole family was from that part of the country, and I went to school in Houston. I got all my education, elementary, high school, and university in Houston, and I was in Houston until we came to Purdue, when I came to Purdue in 1975. So my history is rooted down in the Texas Gulf Coast. And there's a lot of stories there, but I've enjoyed the Midwest an awful lot, yes.
Did you go to, what college did you go to?
I went to the University of Houston.
Okay.
And the reason I went to the University of Houston was probably a lot of the reasons that today's college students pick for their, make their decision about higher education on. First of all, I was interested in nursing. And the University of Houston, which was at that point a private university, it started as a private university and did not become part of the Texas state system of higher education until some years later. But I was interested in nursing, and at that time, I knew that I wanted to get an academic degree in nursing. I did not want to go to one of the many diploma schools that were around. I wasn't sure about what I would do with my career, but I knew I would be much better off starting from a baccalaureate degree. So University of Houston offered such a degree, and so I signed up there. Second thing, it was I could live at home, and so that reduced the expenses. And at that time, University of Houston allowed students to pay a monthly fee for their tuition. And my parents paid $30 a month for me to go to school.
Wow.
Now, that was $30 a month for 12 months because the nurses went, we had maybe about a month of break, but because of the high necessity for a lot of clinical experience, we didn't have the same breaks that other students had. We went more in the summertime than the other students did.
Where did you develop an interest in nursing? Did you always have sort of...
Well,
would you decide on that?
I think at the time I was at that stage in my life, there were three choices for women who wanted a profession: teaching, secretarial, or nursing. And since I was always interested in mathematics and in science aspects, I gravitated more to nursing. Now, a lot of people then, as well as now, would question, what on earth do nurses use mathematics for? But it served me well later, and it also gave me a lot of opportunity to just hone my deductive skills. After I graduated with my degree from the University of Houston, I went to work for the Houston Public School System as a school nurse. Now, the reasons that was an attractive option was that, first of all, the Houston Independent School District, they only hired nurses who had baccalaureate degrees, so I was in a very exclusive group. Secondly, because very few nurses then had college degrees, they paid nurses at the same salary that they paid their teachers with masters, because at that time all you needed was a nursing license. So they looked upon the addition of additional work to satisfy the bachelor's requirements as the equivalent of the master's work that they required for teachers. Thirdly, the hours were attractive, and I had the summers free so I could go back out and work at the hospital in the Texas Medical Center. So it was really a nice combination of both worlds. I worked for the public schools for 5 years, and then after I married, I resigned and went back to school. And I went back to the University of Houston. It was about maybe a year after Sputnik was launched and orbited the Earth. And the U.S. was saying, training enough scientists. And so they instituted what was called the National Defense Education Act. And it was to encourage more people to get an education in the sciences. And so I was able to take advantage of that program because when I was in nursing, I took, I called them ghetto courses, anatomy and physiology for nurses, chemistry for nurses, and that's what they were. They were ghettos. They were just for the nursing students. And so they didn't count as prerequisites for the other things I would have to do. So I spent 2 years as a post-baccalaureate student cleaning up that stuff and taking a lot of algebra and trig and calculus, some of those stuff. And it's ironic, you know, my coursework wasn't good enough to use as a prerequisite, but I was teaching the courses that I was taking. So that was kind of fun. Then I began, once I got after I did that, then I was able to start enrolling and matriculate in a graduate program. And I matriculated in an interdisciplinary program called biophysics. And the graduate program was set up that they took students with undergraduate degrees in either in biology, chemistry, physics, or mathematics. And then what happened, these students took many of the same courses, but then when it came time to do your research, you had to select an area to do your research. So I was on the biophysics track and really just thoroughly enjoyed my chemistry and my mathematics, and I really got a good dose of mathematics in. And then when it was time for me to start deciding on doing a master's thesis, my academic advisor said, well, you've done well in your coursework, and you've demonstrated that you've got the discipline, so you don't have to write a master's thesis. You can go on now and start your PhD research. So I was able to do that. And it was an interesting, not only was the coursework varied and quite interdisciplinary, I was also the only woman in it. And so that had both interesting social ramifications, had some academic ramifications, but I was a little older. I was in my twenties, and it didn't bother me quite that much.
And then what did you do? Did you get your PhD?
I got my PhD in biophysics, and then I applied. And because of the National Defense Education Act, I paid not a penny for my graduate work. In fact, I even got a $300 a month stipend, and they paid for all my books and everything. So I really got a PhD. on a very economical way. Well, I knew that I was interested in biology and mainly physiology coming from my nursing background, and I'd always been interested in that. So I decided, well, now that I had this particular coursework and a satisfactory academic record, I wanted to get a credential in physiology. So I applied once again after the Public Health Service as a nurse who had a doctoral degree for a postdoc fellowship. And I was awarded the postdoctoral fellowship, so then I went to Baylor College of Medicine and took a 2-year postdoc in primarily cardiovascular physiology. Mm-hmm. And then after that, then I began teaching. I was a half-time faculty member in the Department of Physiology at Baylor College of Medicine, and right across the street in the Texas Medical Center, there was Texas Woman's University College of Nursing, who had graduate programs in nursing, and so I taught half-time there. So it was fun.
Yeah, it worked out very well. And then you got married?
Uh-huh. No, I got married before I started graduate school.
Oh, okay, all right. And then your path, what was the career path next after that?
After that, I got my PhD in 1970. did my two-year postdoc, but I was already doing teaching before the postdoc time was completely over. But then I got a faculty position. I was an assistant professor at TWU, and I was an instructor in physiology at Baylor. And this was after the end of 72. Well, in 74, Les was recruited to Purdue. And I didn't come. I stayed in Houston. And because my career was just getting started, and I just needed a little more foundation. And at the time, the Department of Physiology had a need for someone to teach renal physiology, which is hard for people to find it. So I talked to the department chairman, and I said, well, I'll be glad to, you know, to take on that responsibility if you will promote me to assistant professor. Now, at Baylor, department heads could promote from instructor to assistant professor. So that was okay, and we worked out that deal. And I was coming up to Purdue periodically at breaks, and I found out that I could interact with the Midwest. And so I just stayed at Baylor 1 year after Les left teaching, and then he came up here, he scouted out a position for me, and then I came to Purdue then in 1975.
Do you have any brothers or sisters, or you know?
I had a brother who was 2 years younger than I was, and when he was a freshman at the University of Houston, he died in an automobile accident.
Most of your studies have been at Houston then, and that's where you were born and raised.
That's where I was born and raised. Never thought I would leave Houston, but as I said, I had the opportunity to come here and sample the Midwest, and Lafayette in particular. We were both busy traveling to meetings then, so we met in St. Louis a lot. Or I'd go to Houston, or Les would come up here, and I just decided, hey, yeah, I liked it.
Good. Now, in 1980, let's talk a little about the School of Nursing. Tell someone,
okay,
the challenges, and you became the head in 1980.
I became the head in 1980. When I came in 1975, there were no doctorally prepared faculty in the School of Nursing, not even the head. And she had a lot of vision, and she wanted somebody with a doctoral degree to sort of get things nudged in that direction.
Right.
And so when I came, I was given the position of the assistant head. And I did a lot of administrative things, but I also got busy designing a pathophysiology course. And I had taught pathophysiology every semester except my first semester here at Purdue. And I taught it not only to the nursing students, I also taught it around the state. I taught it through continuing education. I taught it to the nurses at home hospital and the nurses in the community. I taught paramedics. So I'd always done a lot of teaching.
Mm-hmm.
And then, as you point out, in 1980, I became the head of the School of Nursing.
Yeah. Then what were some of the challenges and any challenging the curriculum changes?
Oh,
faculty?
Yes.
Anyway.
At that time, you have to realize I came from a much more clinically sophisticated healthcare setting. I came from the Texas Medical Center. Something like 15 hospitals, graduate schools, medical schools, schools of public health. I mean, it was.
It was
huge.
A medical camp. It was a camp.
Oh yes, yes. And while there was still an awful lot of restriction on nurses, and nurses were still looked upon, you know, giving baths, emptying bedpans, that kind of thing, passing pills and giving shots. Nursing throughout the country was beginning to be sort of a sleeping giant that was beginning to move and wake up. And so when I came here, one of my biggest challenges was to try to bring what I call the 20th century nursing into this community.
Mm-hmm.
And those were some of my biggest challenges. And Helen would send me out in a pack of wolves. You know, they would be physicians. Well, what is this nursing diagnosis? Nurses don't diagnose. Well, yes, nurses do diagnose things that nursing can treat. It was that kind of thing, and so I tackled it, and we made some changes, and it's quite different today.
Were you involved in recruitment for faculty and student
yes.
enrollment?
Oh yes.
Right.
Yes.
And then you moved into the those with advanced degrees. You're getting more faculty that had advanced degrees.
Actually, we were pretty well set. The accreditation process required that your faculty have advanced degrees, master's degrees primarily. So my task then was to continue keeping a cadre of graduate prepared nurses, and so I did that, recruited students, and then we had a big curriculum change that wanted to come in. About the 60s, there was a new movement in American nursing. Diploma schools that were owned and run by hospitals were beginning to close. It was expensive, and hospitals were just turning their attention to other expensive things like intensive care units and that kind of thing.
Right.
So they really wanted to get out of the education business. And at that time, there was another nursing shortage. There's always a nursing shortage, it seems. An educator by the name of Mildred Bontag came up with the idea of putting nursing programs in community colleges, a two-year program, and awarding an associate degree. But at least there was some college credit. Well, this movement just blossomed into a huge movement. And the hospitals liked it because they would still bring these AD students from the community colleges into their hospitals. And student nurses that had experience in hospitals, they were the future staff. So the hospitals got the best of both worlds. They didn't have to maintain accreditation standards. That was up to the educators. They didn't have to hire faculty. That was up to the organizations. Well, as I understand it, in the state of Indiana, when this idea of increasing the number of community colleges to give technical degrees began to surface, particularly IU and Purdue were not happy. They did not want a competing junior college system. So they agreed to offer two-year programs, and this was the origin of the regional campuses. So nursing came into Purdue as an associate degree program. After a few years, the two-year programs of all kinds, from nursing to aviation technology, were brought then into the new School of Technology under Dean Rossi, and he was a big supporter of this type of education. Well, a few years after I got here, or even before I got here, students that graduated with an AD degree in nursing from Purdue wanted more. They had come to Purdue for whatever reason. Their parents were alums, but they wanted a baccalaureate degree. And by the early 1970s, nurses were also wanting to go to graduate school, so they had to have a bachelor's degree. And the situation was this. We would graduate around 60 associate degree nurses. By that time, Helen had added what we call the upper division, a bachelor's completion program. But you had to be an RN to get into that program. So here we were. We were graduating 60 nurses a year who had associate degrees, and then they could sit for their licensing exam, and if they were successful, they'd be registered. We admitted 30 RNs to the bachelor's program. Lots of unhappy AD grads and parents. And even though we would say to the new nurses who you had to come into the AD program, you will be entering an associate degree program. And that is what you will graduate with, is an associate degree. And then the parents of the students would pipe up and they'd say, but you offer a bachelor's degree in nursing, don't you? Yes, we do. But, and that was all they heard. So when I became head, even before I became head, in 1978, the School of Nursing here at Purdue had begun to look at how can we offer what we call a generic baccalaureate program, meaning you come in as a freshman, you are in a baccalaureate program. So we began talking about that, and Helen appointed me to be a chairman of a committee to look at this, and we looked at it very carefully for about 2 years, put a lot of work in it. And we decided, well, of course, we're going to have to square it with the Commission of Higher Education. Well, they were not very amenable to having nurses, as I call them, uppity nurses who had baccalaureate degrees or master's degrees. And the hospitals did not want to have only nurses with baccalaureate degrees available for their staff. They thought, well, we'd have to pay them more. Well, they really didn't, but it turned out that they didn't pay them more. But the nurses wanted their baccalaureate degrees. So this group and I talked about it, and finally at one meeting, a light bulb went on in my head. And I said, you know, the Commission for Higher Education only needs to approve new degree programs. They have no jurisdiction over curriculum. And Purdue already has the permission to grant a baccalaureate degree in nursing, although we've been limiting it to this completion program. We will just change the curriculum, and we will modify our baccalaureate curriculum so that we can accommodate incoming freshmen. So Purdue still has, I imagine, the right to award an AD in nursing, and they do it still at North Central. But that was one of my challenges, so in 1982 we admitted our first freshman to a 4-year baccalaureate program. And that was a very, very interesting year as head of the School of Nursing, because we still had the first two AD years. So we had an AD program. We had the first year of the new baccalaureate program, and we had the last year of the upper division baccalaureate. So we were running three different curricula in 1 year.
How about that? Right. One of the things that I noticed the school established is that freshman scholars program.
Yes.
You were involved in that.
Yes, yes. We decided that we wanted the best. We'd always had gotten very good students. I mean, that's been a hallmark of Purdue University School of Nursing. And we just decided, well, we want people to compete, and we will take the best of the best and give them a little money and have a meet with them once an hour a week to sort of start introducing them to the bigger picture of nursing. So we started with five freshman scholars, awarded them $100 for the first semester, and had them in this freshman scholar seminar. And it's still going, and it's much stronger, and there's a lot more freshman scholars than we started.
Is it funded by the school? How does the funding come? Is it funded by the school?
The school funded it.
Yeah. Good. Okay. Now, you've been really interacting with students all this time, and you taught all the time you were here. Didn't lose any touch with the students.
Oh, no, I did not. In fact, I said, you know, I did not invest all that time in school to become an administrator. I invested that time in school to get a knowledge base so I could be a teacher. So, yes, I always taught. And the fun thing about that was because I taught pathophysiology, which was now a required course in the new baccalaureate curriculum. It had been an elective course when we had the upper division of 2 years for bachelor's. It now became required. And because it was a required course, and because I was the only one teaching it, I got to meet almost every one of the students that came through. And they had the head of the School of Nursing as their instructor.
Yes. One of the other things I was going to ask you about, there's still a shortage. The people talk so much about the shortage of nurses.
It's getting worse, yeah.
There are many people that are enrolled in the programs, but there's just so the facility.
Well,
the balance is just off whack.
The thing is, number one, women have a lot more options these days. Mm-hmm. So they're opting out for more lucrative careers, careers that are more respectful of the women in them. There's not, I mean, it's a lot better than it was when I came up, but there's still a lot of people that do not look upon, that look down on nurses and see them as maybe a little bit better than domestics. The third thing is the demand for nurses is increasing so much. We have an aging population. Nurses are working in industry for healthcare or companies. They are being used for, they've just been able to go into so many more things. The other thing is, a lot of institutional nursing is very, very demanding. There's not enough nurses, so you hear about this thing of mandatory overtime, and the patients in hospitals are sicker. When I was a student, we would have patients in the hospital for at least 7 days after a cataract surgery. Well, by the time they got to that point, they were pretty independent. And now, you know, everything is outpatient surgery. So it's a higher level of acuity of patients. The nurses are stretched much thinner. They have monitors and things that we did not used to have that require, it's
the technology.
It's just the demand.
Right.
Yeah. Exactly. And so nurses get tired. They get burned out.
Yeah. How about outreach? You've always had a big continuing education program. Clara Bell ran a lot.
Yes,
of that.
Uh-huh.
That still goes on, though.
It goes on, not to the same extent that it did, because there was a time when a lot of nurse employers wanted to make sure that nurses had continuing education so that they stayed up on the cutting edge. And there was a time that while it was never demanded here in Indiana, a lot of states required mandatory continuing education. So those continuing education programs had to be offered. And that's what Clara was in charge of. And I did a lot of my pathophysiology and how to read a 12-lead ECG and that kind of thing under the auspices of School of Nursing Continuing Education.
The enrollment has increased.
School of Nursing? Oh,
right.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
And the demand for nurses is increased, but yet there's the shortage. So
right now, even though we have more students, we have probably 50% more students than we did about at the time. When I was head, we kept the enrollment around about 400. We could handle that with faculty and clinical settings and things. Now it's in 600. So, and a big problem with further increasing the number of graduates is there's now a huge critical shortage of qualified nursing faculty. So the shortage is at all levels.
Mm-hmm.
They still have a lot of students coming into the field, but they're just being sucked up in so many different places that the supply cannot keep up with the demand.
Okay. Well, another thing you have your curriculum advisory committee. Now, how did you start it?
Oh, yes. It's a community advisory committee. We would meet about every other month, and we would inform these members of the community. Some of them were nurses, but they were also lay people, of what was going on in the School of Nursing, what changes were there, what programs we were being offered, what did they think about nursing doing thus and so. And not only were they able to provide a new perspective to what we were doing in the school, they were also good ambassadors out in the community for the School of Nursing. And I had that, and I think I thought it worked out very well. Because of the changes in the school and the changes in the focus, then like a lot of things, you have to change your direction.
Right, exactly. Diversity within, we usually try to keep that, and of course you've got the five female, but there's quite a few males are in.
Yes,
right.
In fact, there are more men going into nursing. Number one, particularly at times of economic economic uncertainty or outsourcing of manufacturing jobs, you will always need nurses. And it's an interesting course of study. You're with people. I mean, it's a really an interesting career. Not only that, it's very financially stable. So more and more men are coming into nursing, but it's still probably less than 10% of the whole mm-hmm. of the whole nursing population. Interestingly enough, in the armed services, 33% of the nurses are men. And you see that the attraction there is not only is there the challenge of nursing and everything, but the thing in the military is that bypasses this respect thing, is that you become promoted in rank. And I mean, and there's no captain in the medical corps who can talk to a colonel in the nursing corps disrespectfully. So there's that.
Mm-hmm. That's interesting. A couple other things. How about the alumni? You got a pretty active nursing alumni, didn't you?
Yes, we still do have a Purdue Nursing
right.
Alumni Organization. Since more of our nurses are spread over the country, then there's not that large a group. When they all stayed here, it was different. But they're still a big supporter of school. They give scholarships to our students, and they are a real friend to the school.
They come back from time to time
uh-huh.
to the alumni reunions, and it's sort of nice
yes.
to see them
yes.
and also what they're doing.
And we often, we now have an annual nursing conference, and a lot of times they will come back as speakers, and they are faithful alumni, and they financially support the school. So, yes, they're a very important part of our foundation.
Talk a little bit about fundraising. That's changed over time, hasn't it? Fundraising for this.
Fundraising, oh yes. when I first came to Purdue.
University-wide as well.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
When Les and I first came to Purdue, we had, and it wasn't in place when we came,
mm-hmm.
but they had one fundraiser, and that was it. So yes, so the fundraising, I mean, has changed so much, and that has been benefit, and we've had development officers who have also cultivated our relationships with our alums and our friends in the community. So yes, that has just skyrocketed.
Right. And you've also had a lot of new equipment. When you were there, you got quite a few of the computerized things, and so you got support from outside from that
yes.
point. The nursing center is a good example.
It is a wonderful example.
Right. And it's good for the community. It's very visible.
Yes, it is. And, of course, we have a simulated intensive care unit. We have a simulated newborn unit. We have a lot of simulations that have really allowed the students to practice. Now, no simulation is equal to an actual living patient. But because patients don't stay in the hospitals very long, and because there are three nursing schools in the Lafayette community, all jockeying for actual patient experience, they're just as tough as the patient population. So we have to at least do the best we can with simulations. And just to give you an idea, when I came, both at Home Hospital and St. Elizabeth Hospital had capacities of 300 plus, and for the most part, they were pretty well occupied. And now they've got two new hospitals that are going to be down to about 150 to 170 patients. And they, you know, that just shows you how little or how the in-hospital time has been cut.
Mm-hmm. One thing with the retail campuses, you've always had programs, and certainly was North Central was one of the first ones,
yes.
wasn't it?
We now when Helen came, she started AD programs, of course, at Lafayette, and then Fort Wayne, Calumet at Hammond, North Central, and Indianapolis. Now, since that time, all of those the Indianapolis campus reverted to IU, and then, IU became dominant then, and Purdue didn't have a presence in Indianapolis anymore. Fort Wayne and Hammond became independent, and only North Central was still attached to Lafayette. And they are becoming academically autonomous now. Mm-hmm. But while they were part of us, and I had responsibility, at least an administrative responsibility, oversight for them, I would go to North Central fall semester and spring semester, and I would meet with them to just sort of let them know what's going on here and day-to-day decisions that had to be made. I mean, I could contact by telephone, or they could contact me, or they could come down here or whatever. Right. But I think that nursing had one of the closest contacts with their counterparts at North Central of just about any of the West Lafayette programs.
Do they draw from that region, from that area?
Yes.
And so the enrollment seat, and they can work in the community?
Yes.
Right.
Oh, yes. And like most regional campuses that are distant from the main campus, it does serve primarily the regional needs
of that area.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Now you're in the teaching academy, and you've got some other awards.
Yes.
And that's very nice.
Yes.
That represents the students.
Well, I love teaching. It's always been what I had aimed for. So even my first year here, I got the best teaching award in the School of Technology from the nursing students. And then I've received several other school awards at the level of the school. And then in 1983, I received the Amico Foundation Award, which is now the Murphy. And there were three faculty members drawn university-wide. So I was one of those, and that was a very, very proud time for me. When the Teaching Academy was instituted, everyone who had won an Amico Award previous to that was automatically inducted into the Teaching Academy. And now there are people being inducted into the Teaching Academy on the recommendation of their peers and the administrators. So it's not just the Murphy and Amico Award winners now, but other good teachers who are certainly deserving of that recognition.
You're one of the fellows. Got any favorite, any specific things on the school or on nursing in general that you
Nursing
research?
Is changing.
It's
changing. The school is changing. It has to change.
What's one of the biggest changes that you have seen in the field of nursing?
In the profession or in the
profession, I would say.
In the profession, yeah. Is the increasing number of nurses who are seeking baccalaureate and higher degrees. Nursing has worked very hard to establish a scholarly base for nursing. Nurses are they're working in a lot of different settings from what they used to work in. They are taking leadership roles that they had not taken in the past. They are much more active in interdisciplinary research and activities. They are really becoming mainstream in universities and colleges.
Mm-hmm.
There is, of course, another big change in nursing, and that is the inability and the concern about keeping up with the demand.
Right.
Another big change is the movement towards what we call advanced practice RNs, nurses who work with most of them work with physicians, but they see patients on their own. They have prescribing privileges to a limited extent, and so their nurses are practicing nursing in a much more autonomous way. They're also practicing away from the hospital. They're practicing in nurse-managed clinics, and the School of Nursing has about three or four nurse-managed clinics. We have one in the School of Nursing here on campus. It does physical examinations and tests blood glucose and cholesterol and those kinds of things. We had family nurse clinic at Monon, we have the nursing center of Carroll County in Delphi. There is a nursing clinic down at Trinity Methodist Church here in Lafayette, which is primarily pediatrics and neonates. So that kind of
reach is really moving.
Oh yes, and so much of so much of what nurses can do is they can foster healthy lifestyles, lifestyle changes. Hospitals and the high technology, while that's what we see, and that's the most high priced stuff, a lot can be done at a much different level, and nurses are good at that. Those nurses like to sit down and teach. They have been taught to interact, to cooperate, I should say, with the patients. Now, that's not to say that physicians aren't, but traditionally, it was physician up here and patient down here, and nurses are more likely to sit down like you and I are now, eye to eye, and talk about things, and that has been a big change through my many years in nursing.
Yeah. Let's see, a couple things in closing. Got a favorite memory of Purdue that you'd like to share with us, or outstanding event?
Well, I have a lot of memories of Purdue. Certainly, the receipt of the Amico Award was a verification to me of my effectiveness at teaching. Actually, I would have memories after every semester when students would write comments to me on my teacher evaluations. Some were critical. Excuse me. Others were just glowing. Others were things like, you know, gosh, this is a hard course. I spent so much time on it, and I didn't get nearly the grade I should have for the amount of time I put. But it was so interesting, and I learned so. So those kinds.
You learn from those evaluations.
Oh, I still have them.
I know exactly.
Yeah. They really do lift me up. But it's been a wonderful experience at Purdue. It turned out better than I ever could have imagined. I love being in the School of Nursing and working with the students. I also enjoyed very much working with the other parts of the university. So several terms on the Senate, several terms on steering committee, that kind of thing. And of course, it's a lot of fun too, because Les and I had so much things that we liked to do that were in the same area. So we sort of entertained each other, and I was involved in the things, in his honors and the things he got to do, and he with me. And it's just been a wonderful time since 1975 here.
Anything specific since you've done since you retired? You just kept active around the university. Since you retired, you sort of kept active around the
university? Yes, I still have an office in the School of Nursing.
Oh, okay.
And I still sort of mentor the younger nurses and some of the graduate students and this new faculty as they prepare to go through the promotion and tenure process.
That's very good. That's very helpful.
Yes, it is very helpful. And because we do not have a large cadre of nurse faculty at the full professor level, I still serve on the area committee for the College of Pharmacy, Nursing, and Health Sciences Area Promotion Committee. And I fill in promotion situations where a full professor is needed if there aren't enough. So, yes, I still stay active, and I come in every morning and do my 30-40 minutes walk around the campus. And
you and your husband with the exercise, right?
Yes.
Right.
And I go into the school around 4:30, and then I change into my walking shoes, and then I drive over to Grant Street Garage Park, and then I walk in the tunnels. And so I walk through Stewart Center and over to the grad houses and down to Marsteller Street Garage and the Union. And so after about 30 minutes, it's a nice walk.
Does he come out walk with you? He walks separately, though.
He walks separately because he's out at out there now in Discovery Park.
Sure.
But and he goes in, and our schedules are a little different. And I've come to be acquainted, at least tip of the hat, acquaintance with a lot of building service personnel. And you know, when you're out walking in at Purdue around 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning, you meet a lot of other people that you wouldn't meet otherwise.
Exactly. And I sometimes see them leaving, you know, while I'm coming to work because they're crossing the street on North Ride, so I know what you're saying.
Yeah.
That's right.
So
yeah.
So it's been interesting to meet all the various people that I have interacted with over the years. Oh, another thing that I enjoyed doing. In 1996, I was approached by the IU School of Medicine Lafayette Center, and I taught medical students physiology from 96 until I retired in 03, taught them renal and endocrine physiology, and so I got acquainted now with another whole bunch of people on this campus, and that was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
That harked back to my teaching days at Baylor. So I sort of, I started teaching nurses and medical students, and I finished my career, my formal career, teaching nurses and medical student physiology.
Anything other special you'd like to share with us, or?
Oh, I think, you know, there's so many things, but I think this sort of hits the highlights
that's
and the
right.
things that.
Do you still go back to, you still have any family that live back
no.
in Houston?
No. Ben, we haven't been back to Houston for a long time.
You did a lot of traveling also with your husband.
I think like you did a lot of traveling with your husband.
Yes.
Oh, we just don't travel as much anymore. We used to travel abroad every summer. In fact, our honeymoon, we married in August, and our honeymoon was a trip to Japan to teach the Japanese Air Defense Corps a course of physiology. So
it started right away.
Oh, yeah. So, yes, we would travel every summer. Now, of course, you have to realize those were the days of generous research grants. They welcomed travel. They welcomed the internationalizing influence for all faculty members. And, the Orient, a number of times, the China Medical Board, Korea,